main thing is just keep your hands inside the boat at all times. Not too busy out there, but just in case you hit anything along the way. Don't want anyone to lose any fingers. Yeah, so all of this is all the college bats, yeah, it's all part of the university. All different colleges. If you guys have any questions along the way, also feel free to ask them. If I don't know the answer, I'll lie to you, but hopefully you won't know any different. Has anyone been punting before?
No.
Good. You have no idea. I'll lie regardless, don't worry. Sorry?
Good ways of being.
Oh, yeah.
Years of experience.
Yeah. I make it up each time, I go different every time. Yeah, on the left there, yeah, that's some Queen's College accommodation. So, like I said, all of this is all the college back about the university. The university was founded in 1209, so it's 809 years old. It was actually founded by Oxford students, which is obviously quite funny because Cambridge and Oxford have a massive rivalry. I'm sure we all know about, well, hopefully we know about maybe. If not, big rivalry, have a boat race along the Thames every year, road match at Twickenham and so on, big rivalry. And that stems back to how Cambridge was founded, because pre-1209, pre-Cambridge, Oxford was the only university about, making it the oldest of course as well. It was mainly occupied by priests and lawyers, and this meant students of the university were protected by something known as church law. This meant if a student committed a crime, they got away with it. They wouldn't be punished. All they had to do was pray for forgiveness, a little slap on the wrist, and that's absolutely it. No hanging or time in prison like a townsperson would suffer. And that's important to the story because in 1209 some Oxford students actually took advantage of this law, took advantage of a young town girl. They raped and killed her. Of course, this horrendous crime, they got away with it. They weren't punished. Now, the townspeople weren't very happy about this. The two social classes didn't get on anyway. The students kind of seen as the upper class gentry. The townspeople were, of course, kind of the lower class peasants, if you will. And this was the last straw. So the townspeople took matters into their own hands, picked up 15 random Oxford students and hanged them in the streets to get their revenge, of course. Now, what it did made the Oxford students that were left very scared that they were going to fall to the same fate. So a lot of them left Oxford and came here to Cambridge and found their own university. So, in the whole university, about 18,000 to 20,000 students, which makes up about 20% of the whole Cambridge population. There's 31 colleges in total that make up all the university. The largest ones, the ones on the river, have about 700 to 1,000 students, and the smaller ones about 200 to 300 students. So it equals out about 18,000 to 20,000. Students came to Cambridge and founded their own university to get away from the townspeople of Oxford. Chose Cambridge of all places because William the Conqueror, after he conquered England in 1066, settled a lot of monasteries here, so half the work was done for a university to be founded here. And that's where the rivalry began, because some stayed in Oxford, some came to Cambridge. They argued about what's better to do, and they still are today. Now, on my right hand side here, this is what you'll see on most postcards from Cambridge. This is King's College, which was founded in 1441 by King Henry VI, when he was just 18 years old. Now, he founded the college essentially as a place for students of Eton to do postgraduate study. He also founded Eton the year before. Eton is near Windsor, it's very prestigious these days. Prince William and Harry studied there, for example. Have to pay quite a lot of money to study there. But originally it was founded for poor orphan boys to get a really good education, learn how to become gentlemen. They would then come here to King's, get a gentleman's degree, secure this gentry status. This degree was basically turn up, drink loads of beer and wine, get really drunk, smoke some cigars. That's absolutely it. No exams whatsoever. So not too different from degrees today. Just don't make time for exams. Sorry? That's all true. Trust me. You're going to be asking me every time now, aren't you? So it's more about networking, meeting people in higher places, socialising with them. It's not what you know, it's who you know. That's what it comes from. And they felt like gentlemen shouldn't be tested, so that's why there was no exams. Now she moved to King's College. King's College today is very famous for its maths and engineering and research. The college is, just because you study a certain subject doesn't mean you have to be at a certain college. It's called a collegiate system. So you choose a college based on accommodation because that's what
this
they are.
Is for maths and engineering.
Yeah, it's what for research purposes, not necessarily to study at though. Medicine is kind of St. John's, most popular probably, and there are a few other colleges that are famous for medicine. But yeah, what you'll do is, colleges are basically accommodation, so you'll choose that based on what you want out of your accommodation, whether you want to live with 6, 12 people, share a bathroom, and obviously the main thing, the price. So you choose your college based on that, you then go to another college to do your lessons. So you live with people that do all kinds of degrees. Just missed it slightly, we will see it on the way back from us here, kind of around the corner of the wall. This is all Clare College. On the left is Clare Fellows Gardens. Every college has their own gardens, but Clare's the most beautiful, probably the whole university. The college itself, though, was founded in 1326, making it the second oldest of the university, just after Peterhouse, which was founded in 1284. But it's the oldest college on the river, so the oldest one you'll see on the tour. So like I said, originally founded in 1326, but quickly went bankrupt. The chap who founded, Richard Badgley, kind of didn't realise how much money he needed to keep a college going, so it went bankrupt. But luckily for the students, it was refounded by a French princess, Elizabeth Wood, Queen Elizabeth de Clare, is what I'm about to say. Now, she had lots of money because of her marriages. She had three husbands who had three things in common. They were all very rich, all very old, all died within a year of the marriage. So you could say she timed it nicely. You could say that. I'm not gonna, you know, grass her up. She was just good at timing.
Yeah, 20 miles.
Way ahead of her time. She knew what she was doing. So yeah, she obviously got a lot of money from these marriages. Used it to found the college and name it after herself. She could do that because colleges used to be named after royalty, people from the Bible. And of course, like I said, she was a French princess. Trinity College, which you'll see on the right side, just over this bridge. Now, the college was founded in 1546 by King Henry VIII. He founded the college, basically, it's a big statement of his power and wealth. So this is Trinity, just here on the right, my right anyway. So two reasons he founded the college, like I said, big statement of his power and wealth. Two different people. One, to St. John's College founder, which is ahead of us. That would be John Fisher, a priest. They didn't get along, so he founded this college to kind of disrespect him, show how much bigger and better he was. But more importantly, two Catholics who founded this, a big statement to them. He recently became a Protestant king through the Reformation, which was basically dissolving lots of monasteries, which is where he got his wealth. Dissolving the monasteries, the land that they were built on was very profitable. So he's basically a big publicity. Now he died about 6 weeks after founding the college, and he donated all the land that he got through dissolving those monasteries to Trinity. So that's why Trinity is the wealthiest college in the world. It's worth just over £2 billion, which is quite a lot for one college. So students will still at undergraduate level, they'll pay £9,000 a year, which is the same for any university. That's because the government cap it. Where the reputation of Cambridge being really expensive is one, when they go do postgraduate study. So if you do masters and doctorate, Cambridge will up their prices where others will drop theirs. But also international students So depending on the course, some international students will pay at least £40,000-£50,000 a year to study here, yeah.
Per year,
that's right. And then you'll pay accommodation on top of that as well. Yeah, things, like I said, they get the wealth through the land. Today, they still own a small part of Wall Street. They used to own a lot more, but a small part they've still got. A lot of land here in Cambridge is owned by the college. You can walk from Cambridge to Oxford, just on their land. Felixstowe Docks, which is near Ipswich. About 40% of the land at Tesco is built on in East Anglia. But the best one is they lease the land to the O2 Arena in London, you know, the big white dome. The land that's built on, they lease that out. So Trinity own the O2, basically. O2 kind of indirectly paid Trinity College, which is obviously pretty unique. And they get a lot of money from it. Now, they've invested that money back into their research. The Trinity is also one of the best academically, because out of the 91 Nobel Prize winners to come out of Trinity, so come out of the university, 32 have come from Trinity College, so more than any other college of the university. Compare that to Oxford, the whole University of Oxford has only produced about 50 Nobel Prize winners. So that's why you can say Cambridge is better than Oxford. It's about 1 to 2 metres deep. So some of it will come to my waist, some of it will be about on my neck. The deepest part is 4 metres, but that's only for a small part. Yeah, we do in the winter when we have a long, when there's been a big rainfall or a big snowfall. Yeah, it messes up the current. The river will go really high and it's really strong. So we're now coming into St John's College. Yep, it's on both sides. In fact, St John's on both sides. John's was founded in 1511 by Lady Margaret Beaufort. That's Henry VIII's grandma. She founded the college. But she actually died a couple of years earlier in 1509. And so she wrote in a will for a close friend of priest John Fisher to carry out the rest of her work on her behalf. But no one actually ever saw the will where he could do this, so it was very suspicious, and that's why Henry VIII didn't really like Fisher. Because he got a lot of credit and a lot of money from it as well. Now the bridge ahead of me, well, I'm about to pass under, this is the Bridge of Sighs. Now there's a Bridge of Sighs in Venice that joins the courtroom to the execution room. And this Bridge of Sighs joins the student accommodation to the exam room, the student execution room, if you will. Queen Victoria came to visit this bridge after it was built in 1891. Said how it reminded her of the one in Venice. Having never been herself, she just heard about it. So that's why a lot of people say how they look nothing alike. I've never been to Venice, so I won't comment. That's so much more. Sorry? No, that's for the chapel that's there. It's been our chapel. Now it's alive. Yeah, this is still part of the campus. So this kind of chalk-coloured square building on my left, this is Cripps Hall. This was the first building to be designed on a computer. Prince Charles actually opened this building. He didn't realise his microphone was still on and everyone could still hear him. When he said it's the ugliest building he's ever seen, it looks more like a multi-storey car park. Funny enough, the people who designed it, Powell and Moyer, actually designed some London multi-storey car parks later on in their career. It's a listed building, which basically means it can't change in any way. It's protected. So that building, yeah, it's grade 2 listed. So they just put up big trees in front of it instead. Cover it up. It's the best they could do.
You only cause everything carbuncles.
Yeah, exactly. And that's first year accommodation for St John's students. It depends which one. So the nicest one which I'll point out is about £250 a week. Some of them are about £150. It ranges between them. So all of this now, this is all Magdalen College. The nicest part of the college is actually after the bridge. This is all part of it still. Magdalen was founded in 1542 by Thomas Audley. He was Henry VIII's Chancellor, so he did a lot of his dirty work during the Reformation. He actually beheaded at John Fisher, who helped found St John's, I mentioned earlier. Now, he couldn't name the college after himself, this Thomas Audley, because he wasn't royalty or from the Bible, of course. He wanted to keep the credit, though. People remember who he was. He was just very arrogant, basically. So to kind of help people remember who he was, he kept the same spelling as Mary Magdalene. That's what he named it after. She was one of Christ's followers. Kept the same spelling as Magdalene. But so that people remember who he was, he changed the pronunciation to sound like his last name, Audley. So that's why I pronounce it Magdalen College, despite the spelling. Like I said, big ego, people remember who he was. Yeah, so you turn around and go back.
Are you going to say the same thing now?
Yeah, probably. Just tell you different dates. Make it a fresh start.
Can't remember any of the dates anyway.
Yeah, so that's part of Magdalen College. That's the last part of it.
How many did you do? 31
in total. There's 8 on the river here. So we've seen 7 so far. No, sorry, 6. Yeah, something like that.
So Oxford has
36
and
Cambridge. 31. Now this bridge we're now passing under, not this one specifically, this one was built about 40 years ago, but the original one that was here was the first bridge over the river. So the river's called the River Cam. This is a bridge. Cam Bridge, Cambridge. That's where the name comes from. The first bridge that was there was wooden, about 700 AD. Now, Magdalen College was also famous for something they're not exactly proud of. It was the last college out of the university to admit women, which was in 1988. So only 30 years ago, women were allowed in, like I said, the last one of the university. Now, the men, when they heard that all these women were going to turn up, of course, they were ecstatic by the news. So to celebrate, they dressed in all black, marched through the city of Cambridge with a coffin, chanting, "Education is dead." But the women got their own back, as they always do. The average grades went up by about 15% the year later, and all 3 Nobel Prize winners to come out of Magdalen College have been women as well. So I've done very well since. C.S. Lewis, who wrote the Chronicles of Narnia, studied here, and was very good friends with the Professor J.R. Tolkien, who wrote Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit. He was a professor at Magdalen College. Typically, yes. So Oxford is more famous for its arts and literature. Cambridge is known for its science. But these days, that's, like I said, it's very stereotypical. These days, it's a bit more equal. Both universities are pretty good at both things. But yeah, Cambridge has got a big science park, which is kind of just over there. So yeah, Cambridge maybe a bit more sciencey. But if you still came and did arts and literature here at Cambridge, you're still going to be doing pretty well anyway.
Thank you.
Cambridge is one of the best in the world. It's where it does its teaching. So it still has lectures and seminars like most universities. But it also has a thing called supervision, which is basically a one-on-one lesson with a professor of your choosing. So for example, about 20, 30 years ago, if you were studying physics, you could have chosen Professor Stephen Hawking as one of your supervisors, your one-to-one lesson, which obviously if you're interested in that kind of thing, is pretty unique, it's pretty cool, you're going to learn a lot, not just because it's him, but because one-to-one, you're going to... It's easier to learn when it's just you and another person.
Did you have a disability at that time?
Yeah. This black door on my left-hand side is called the trap door because some second years once played a prank on all the new students. They redirected all the fire exit signs towards that door and about 4 in the morning set up a fire alarm because the students followed all the signs and came running into the water. And then some other students in the 60s, they didn't like their professor too much, so just before graduation, they stole his car and actually hanged it off this bridge, the Bridge of Sighs. If you Google hanging Bridge of Sighs car, you'll see an old Austin 7 below that bridge. It's quite a picture. Yeah, they are. Don't have much studying to do, clearly. Got a lot of free time. Stephen Hawking actually, he started to become disabled as he was at Cambridge. So he wasn't disabled when he actually came to Cambridge at first, but he diagnosed, that's what whilst he was here.
Was he still attached to the university, college?
Yeah, so he was part of Gomble and Keyes College. The first college he studied at, I'll tell you about when we go past it. But he did his research at Gomble and Keyes, which is kind of just behind Trinity and King. Now, just behind me on my right-hand side, some of you might have turned your head, this is St John's New Court here. Now, that's second-year student accommodation for St John's students. So that's some of the nicest. That's where Harry Potter was supposed to be filmed, but it was going to cost about £36,000 a day. So instead they went to Oxford, where of course it's half the price. It's half as nice though. Now that building was designed to be perfectly symmetrical. The chap who designed it, Henry Hutchinson, was so obsessed with this symmetry that apparently he used to sit on the grass waiting for a student to open a window. If they opened it on the left-hand side, he'd run in and make sure a student opened it on the right-hand side as well. So it's perfectly symmetrical all day long. Very OCD. It's got a very tiered nature to it as well, so it's nicknamed the Wedding Cake. Weddings do take place there in the summer. They'll cost you a lot of money, and the waiting list is about 4 or 5 years or so. Students also have their end of academic year parties called the May Balls that take place in mid-June. Don't know why they call them May Balls then. And it's just basically a big party. Tickets will cost you about £350-400. And they have these massive firework displays, and Trinity and St John's compete every year for the best firework display. Of course, they've got these wonderful backdrops as well. So it's quite a picture. A famous student of St John's College, who became a fellow of Trinity, would be a chap called Dr. John Dee. Now, he's famous because he was the first ever documented spy. So he used to go around the rest of the world spying on behalf of Queen Elizabeth. Now, he'd write letters to her, of course, telling her what he found out. But like any good spy, he'd remain completely anonymous. So he used to sign off his letters 007, and she signed off her letters M. Of course, that's where Ian Fleming got the initial works of James Bond from. The two zeros, he put dots in the middle of them to look like eyes for spying. Seven believed to be his lucky number, because you need luck when spying. And M was for Majesty and Monarch. That is a true story, by the way. That one's not a lie. That one's true.
Just about the question, that one.
Yeah, exactly. That's the one that everyone questions. That one is true. Yeah, so there's like a bit of training, obviously, to tell you what you're supposed to say and all this kind of stuff. Yeah, and a bit of the punting as well. You need to be able to move the boat. So obviously we just had the bank holiday, and it was just busy as anything, just rammed. You can hardly see the water, yeah. So many boats.
The weather was nice.
Exactly, yeah, exactly. All relies on the weather and the weekend. Yeah, you don't so much move around the boat, she just smash into them, get them out of the way. Knock people in. I knocked in 3 people this weekend. It's quite fun. Now the building on my left is Trinity's Library, the Wren Library, designed by Sir Christopher Wren, who also designed St Paul's in London. The ground floor doesn't have any books on it, and that's because the river used to flood every year, so to protect the books they're on the upper levels. But the windows are also impregnated with moths, you know, the little bugs, because they protect the books from UV rays from the sun, stopping them growing really old and tattered. Now, Trinity College, the library, has Isaac Newton's Principle of Mathematics in there, which he studied there, and all his original sketches as well, by the way. There's also the first editions of Winnie the Pooh in that library. The author, A.A. Milne, also studied at Trinity College too. And then another famous student, whose books aren't in the library, don't think he even read one or wrote one himself, Prince Charles studied here at Trinity as well. Now, he actually went to study at Oxford first, but because his grades were so poor, he got rejected. There's something like 2 D's and an E. And he only got let into Cambridge, not because of his grades, but because he got his mum to write him a letter this time. Of course, he couldn't reject the Queen. Now, he came here to study anthropology, archaeology, and history. Before he came to the university, he wrote to the master, the head of the college, with a special request. He was to be treated like any other student. No royal exceptions, just an ordinary guy getting a degree. So on his first day, he arrived by helicopter, landing on the lawn on my right, with about 8 bodyguards, just like every other Cambridge student. Now, he studied anthropology, archaeology and history. He graduated with a 2-2, the third best grade you can get at university. Because the professors of his course felt so sorry for one of the bodyguards who followed him everywhere, into lectures and exams, they said he could do the same degree. And of course, the bodyguard beat Prince Charles, getting a 2-1. Sorry? No, no, his son did. William at St Andrews. Prince Charles came here. Trinity is Trinity Hall, founded in 1350 by Bishop William Bateman in Norfolk. He founded the college because of the Black Death plague that spread across Europe at this time. Killed a lot of priests and lawyers that mainly occupied the university around there. That's because if you're very sick and about to die, you'd see a lawyer to sort out your money and your will, see your priest that hopefully sends you into heaven. But because the plague was so contagious and deadly, all these guys were dying out quite rapidly. So he founded the college to bring these people back to the community. Very famous for law, but it's also famous because that's where Stephen Hawking did his first degree. Just there, at Trinity Hall. On the left, just behind that red brick building. So he did his first degree in Oxford, in fact. But he was pretty sure his teachers didn't like him, and he didn't like them. So he asked for the best grade possible. If they gave it to him, he said he'd leave him alone and come to Cambridge. But if they gave him anything less, he threatened to stay in Oxford and make their life hell. So that's how he ended up doing his postgraduate at Trinity Hall. And then, like I said, he did his research at Gombel and Keys College, which is just behind these.
Was his first wife also a student?
Yes, she was. I don't know what she was studying though. I can't remember off the top of my head. I could lie, but I wasn't quick enough. So again, this is Clare College on the left. We didn't see it quite earlier. Clare College is where David Attenborough studied, for example. The very famous nature TV presenter. Of course, famous for narrating Blue Planet, Planet Earth. He studied here, have his lunch in the gardens on my right, I mentioned earlier, nearly every day, weather permitting, and where he's been quoted to say his love of nature actually began the inspiration for the programmes came from. James Watson, one half of Watson and Crick, who together discovered the structure of DNA. James Watson studied here at Clare College as well. And this bridge we're now passing under, this is Clare Bridge, the oldest bridge on the river, built in 1640. It's the oldest because Oliver Cromwell knocked down all the other ones during the English Civil War. And he was keeping his base of operations in King's College Chapel. He kept that one because it was the first stone. All the other ones were wooden still. So it obviously held up the best in war. And by only having one way in, one way out, obviously it's a lot easier to defend. If creating a moat around Cambridge, basically. And I'll pick the King's on my left-hand side. On the left of the graph is King's College Chapel. It's the second largest chapel after the 16th chapel. That's in Rome, in Italy. Now, some students called the Night Climbers, they once put a traffic cone on top of that left-hand spire of the chapel. Of course, the college weren't very happy, so they got the builders in straight away, put scaffolding all the way to the top of that spire. It took them 3 days to do, because they had to take their time not ruin the building. But on the fourth morning, when they were eventually going to take the cone off, it wasn't there. That's because the students the night before moved it from the left spire to the right spire, so the work had to start all over again, about a week until that cone left the chapel. Some other students in 2009, just before a Christmas carol service that the Queen was attending, put Santa hats on four corners as well. So there's actually anti-climbing spikes at the base of the spires now. The window at the front is Renaissance glass, so it tells the story of the Bible. During World War II, they actually took out that glass, fearing it would be bombed during the Blitz. But because there's about 60,000 different pieces, and no one thought to number them, no one knew how it actually went back together after the war. It took 5 years to put the last piece back in. Biggest jigsaw puzzle ever. And the white building next to it is the Gibbs Building, named after James Gibbs, who wrote the Book of Architecture. That book was obviously used to design that building, but also the White House, the first White House in Washington. You might see a similarity, they're both white. This bridge ahead of me, this is Kingsbridge, or as it's known in Mandarin, Kong Chao. this famous Chinese poet, Su Jimo, has got his poem, Farewell to Cambridge, engraved on a stone on top of the bridge. It's very important to their culture, it's in like their national curriculum. The loosest kind of best way to explain it is like, it's kind of like our Shakespeare. It's like the same kind of importance. Student accommodation. So this is probably some of the nicest accommodations of the whole university. It was designed to be that way, anyway. So the rooms have an ensuite, kitchen, king-size bed, a fireplace, their own study room, a little library as well. Very big rooms. So these three windows on the left, just after the wall, those three windows, that's the size of one room for one student. Yeah, so that's just one, like, yeah. So they don't like live with other people in like one confined space. They kind of have this kind of a mini house in their own kind of room. So these rooms were given to the best and brightest students after a second year exams. If you're in one of the top 48 places, you'd be given one of the 48 rooms. So like I said, best and brightest. Nowadays it's on ballot, mostly given to students who are on scholarships. If not, these are the rooms that cost about £250 a week. So that was best and brightest. So the punishment for your lack of intelligence was being put in this one. Which is obviously a very different looking building. It's the Erasmus Building, part of Queen's College accommodation. The chapel designed it, Sir Basil Spence. He came into a lot of criticism for the building, its appearance. He defended his building by saying it's supposed to reflect the view on the opposite side, which obviously when you have a look, sounds like a load of rubbish. And that's because what you don't know is Sir Basil Spence actually studied at Oxford. So a lot of people think he designed it to look that ugly on purpose to get one over on Cambridge. He was also a bit of an alcoholic, and it was built in the 60s, so it's another reason for why it's so ugly. Very abstract. So like I said, that's Queen's College. So all of this now is all Queen's College. Probably the last college we'll talk about. This was founded in 1448. By the wife of Henry VI. Henry VI founded Queen's, his wife, Margaret of Anjou, founded Queen's. So that's why it's called Queen's. But two more queens founded it later on, hence why the apostrophe is after the S. Elizabeth Woodville and Queen Anne Neville. And that kind of goes back to the whole publicity stuff. Investing into education is quite low. So on my right is more accommodation, looks more like a London hospital though, built in the 70s. On the left is the President's Lodge. Every college has their own master, who's the head of the college. But because you can't be a master of royalty, Kings has a Provost and Queens has a President. They have this big mansion in the college on a, at least a six-figure salary. A very cushy job. And then what interlinks those two buildings is this bridge here. You'll never guess the name. It's the Mathematical Bridge. Really, it's called the Wooden Bridge. For six reasons. We'll see it as we come to it. Now, it was designed by Isaac Newton's student, William Etheridge, using the mathematical term radial tangent trussing, which is basically a lot of straight lines to make a curve. So all the pressure of the bridge sits on the stone blocks either side. If I was really strong, I could pick up that bridge, put it back down, without the need to unscrew or untighten anything, be as safe as before. That's why it's nicknamed Mathematical. That's the third one of its type. That one was built in 1904. Famous students of Queen's include Stephen Fry and Sacha Baron Cohen. Of course, Sacha Baron Cohen is famous for Ali G and Borat. They were part of this amateur acting group called the Footlights, which has then produced stars such as Hugh Laurie, Don Cleese, Rowan Atkinson, who plays Mr. Bean, and Eddie Redmayne, who played Stephen Hawking in the film about Stephen Hawking, The Theory of Everything. Eddie actually studied at Trinity College, but was part of the same acting group founded at Queen's. Now, a lot of students like to go punting themselves, do this thing called bridge jumping, which is basically when you get to a bridge, you climb up one side, run to the other end and jump off, try and land back into the same boat as you left from. Of course, they've usually had a few drinks, so they miss most of the time. Yeah. I guess that's the idea too. This pub on my left-hand side is the Anchor Pub. Used to be a live jazz club, and that's where Pink Floyd played their very first concert.
Did they actually go to university here, Pink
Floyd? No, I don't think so. I think one of them went to the other university, ARU, Anglo Ruskin. I never remember his name. So that's why they're the first people.
Thank you.